All right, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming. This is our first in hopefully a long series of straight talks. So tonight is a bit of an experiment, shall we say, because we're going to see, especially with our great moderator, how we can loosen the conversation so that we can actually really say what's on our minds and emotional. So I'm the CEO of Kyiv Post. I'm Luke Shania. Thank you very much for coming tonight. I know it was very last minute, but at the same time, I think this is going to be something special. So on that note, I'm going to introduce Alisa, who put this event together. So come on. It's good. And then we're going to turn it over to the experts.
Thank you, everyone, for coming tonight. The Straight Talk project we created as a series of events where we want the representatives from business to have an honest dialogue with the government about the questions that bother business today. And today we start with our first topic, which is pressure on business. And I hope you feel comfortable and speak up if you have anything to say tonight. Thank you again.
Hi, everyone, and thanks for coming. So I'll quickly explain what the whole idea was about. The whole idea is that there are so many conferences in Ukraine, and I think most of you are tired of this sometimes boring speakers, boring presentations. You've got things you want to ask. You can't ask this because this is not too polite. And we came up with this idea. We're going to do this sort of similar thing to a hard talk on BBC, but we're going to call it Straight Talk. And thanks to the Kyiv Post for supporting this and FCArb. So our idea is very different, and I think that there are lots of positive aspects for those who are in the audience. It's going to be entertaining and lively. Obviously, the downside for the speakers is that they will hear some harsh questions, and they will sometimes find it hard to answer those. But I'm sure they will enjoy it as well in the end. So the format is as follows: we're going to have quick questions and quick answers. It's not a formal, no one's going to give any formal presentations. So answers should not be more than 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes maximum. Or maybe let's see how it goes, but it's not any major sort of detailed answers. And everyone from the audience can just raise your arm and someone's going to give you a microphone and you can ask your question, especially if you disagree with something. If you hear someone's talking, telling something which you totally disagree with, you just raise your arm and say, I disagree with that. Can you please tell me your thoughts on this? And I think this is the first in the series. There's going to be more of this, but I hope you will genuinely enjoy this. Thanks, everyone, for coming. So I will introduce our guests. We have two groups of people here, three people from business. First is Jonathan Popper. Jonathan is vice president at Ukrnafta, the largest oil producer in Ukraine. A company which is partly owned by the state, partly owned by Ukrainian oligarch, Mr. Kolomoisky. Correct? Correct. See, question
absolutely.
And answer.
Yeah.
See, I've did my homework. Okay. Next one we have here, Mikhail Merkulov, who is with the company Arricano. Most of you have heard about SkyMall. SkyMall is one of the shopping centers that had the major radar attack, what they call it, a radar attack, where they have been attacked by what they call raiders. And we're going to speak about very interesting stuff with Mikhail. And Sergey Vovchenko, who is with Milk Alliance. It's a Ukrainian exporter of milk products, which is exporting to more than 30 countries abroad. Very successful story, I'm sure. So this is first group of people. Second group is our sort of, we can call them government. Some of them can say we're not government anymore, but they have been affiliated with the government, so this is how we group them. Iaroslav Gregirchak, again, he can say he has nothing to do with the government, but he's a deputy business ombudsman who apparently has a role of helping business to withstand pressure from the government. Then next speaker is Yulia Marushevska, who used to be head of Odesa Customs. Yulia, this is not anymore. Currently, Yulia is an activist, and Yuriy Terentyev, who is the only a representative from this group of the government people who's currently serving as the head of the Ukrainian Anti-Monopoly Committee. Okay, you think he's not the government, but in everyone's perception, obviously you are the government because you're performing the government's function. Okay, so let's start now with the main part. First, we're going to start with the easy question to Jonathan Popper. Jonathan, he's been in the oil and gas industry for 30 years, worked in many countries. Some of them are also known as very sort of difficult countries to do business with, like Russia, Kazakhstan. What else was there, Jonathan?
Colombia, even UK is difficult.
Yeah, but in terms of pressure on business and corruption. So can you compare all of those other countries with Ukraine? Can you say what are the main difficulties which are specific to Ukraine? How is Ukrainian business environment different from in those countries?
Okay, so my experience in Ukraine in the business environment is very much colored by the company I'm with, which is Ukrnafta. So I don't think everything that I would have to say is typical of business. Do I need to repeat that?
No,
good, I'll keep going, great. So, Ukraine has its differences, it has its similarities. So it came out of the Soviet system, it still has a lot of that, I see a lot of that in my company. It has a lot of the behaviors that you see there as well. The oligarchs, the corruption which we have, and the difficulty of enforcing law. This is common. But other places I've been have very active terrorism in Colombia. We don't have that here. You know, the god of oil and gas put oil and gas in some funny places. And Ukraine is one of the better places, actually.
So you don't find Ukraine as much worse than Russia, for example? Because many people would tell you, I'll tell you, many businessmen would say Ukraine is much more corrupt than Russia. And obviously you're thinking about this, how come, right? Russia has an image of a very corrupt country. But people doing business, like Russian businessmen, when they still did business in Ukraine, they would come here and they would always say, Ukrainian court system, Ukraine is so much more corrupt than Russia. What do you think?
I think it's a matter of degree. You know, I think trying to differentiate is tough. I think the more interesting question is, how is it changing? Is it getting better or worse?
Is there any progress since 2014? Obviously hard for you to say, but in your 18 months, what do you think? Has any progress been made?
I see two things going on. I mean, I see things like Prozora. I see a serious attempt to have open tenders to improve procurement. And I see negative things, the interference, the attempts to intimidate, to manipulate the law, manipulate the rules. So it's a mixture. There's no simple it's great or it's bad. Some things get better, some things get worse.
All right. Well, that's a good answer. Then let's maybe move to Yuriy Terentyev, who's the head of the Anti-Monopoly. I think first question is, Anti-Monopoly Committee, historically, for those who don't know, historically for many, many years was perceived as sort of a normal state body. That, okay, it does nothing too bad, it's not very intervening, it's not really harassing businesses to a large extent, like it's not a tax inspection or something. But on the negative side, Anti-Monopoly Committee has allowed for the Ukrainian economy to be highly monopolized. And the first question, just can you say yes or no? Do you agree that Anti-Monopoly Committee has not done its job in the past by allowing the monopoly to be highly monopolized?
I think it's a complex question.
But is it
a complex meaning, not difficult, but a complex meaning that there are a lot of interdependencies and there is much more than just the role of one body whom you can say that you are there to watch that monopolization is not taking place. We can say that, yes, currently, looking at statistics, we can say that turnover in the markets which are monopolized in the sense that there is, for example, a state of natural monopoly, like tariffs, like electricity, utilities, that we have the following tendency. The pie, meaning that the overall money in the economy, in terms of consumer spend, they are moving towards area, towards sectors, so to say, which are in the state of monopolization. Because tariffs increase, and customer spend is more moving. There is much less of a share of wallet of a specific customer left, for example, to be spent on just normal consumer goods.
So in other words, the Ukrainian market, there are several industries which are highly monopolized, and you're right in saying one is energy, for example, is highly so. Just maybe not everyone's a lawyer, economist here. What Anti-Monopoly Committee is supposed to do, it's supposed to not allow the market to be monopolized, because but monopolies and abuse of monopoly position is always bad. Right?
There are two aspects. So on the one side, we do our main function, one of our main functions is concentration control. So we should not allow for monopolization via acquisition of by one business of another to take place. But on the other side, we cannot fully destroy barriers which are created by the government regulation, which hinder the access of new businesses to the Ukrainian economy. And we cannot stop Ukrainian business, for example, from going bankrupt, or we cannot stop foreign investors from leaving Ukraine. If, for example, if you have a situation in the market, when, for example, when there are 10 participants, each having 10% market share, but eight of them leave, then there are two remaining.
Yeah,
so this we cannot stop. But I would say that there are several ways how we can impact, apart from concentration control. A very big area of our activity is promoting competition. And if you look per annum on the number of decisions which are taken by Anti-Monopoly Committee, we are talking about approximately 2,500 decisions. About 700 of them per year, they are aimed against governmental bodies for discriminatory regulation, for discriminatory actions against businesses. And this is indeed a big area of our activity. So one of our, apart from concentration control, big job we are doing is promoting competition and eliminating barriers which cause monopolization. Because if you look at
straight talk. So obviously you're gonna list all of those things which Anti-Monopoly did. I'm sure lots of them good things that you've done to promote competition. Lots of reasons. Laws are not right. Economy is bad. Why it was hard for you to do a job. But can you just say, do you think the Anti-Monopoly Committee did good job in the past on not allowing the markets to be monopoly or not? Do you think? Because I think the answer is obvious. It hasn't done a good job. It hasn't done a good job in the past. Do you agree with that?
Partially.
Okay, partially. Good.
But I'd say that
the next question.
Most anti-competitive actor in Ukraine is the state. It is actually
the state which is causing
the monopolies. It is the state which is the greatest threat to competition.
Then the next question. Okay, but it has done bad things in the past. It wasn't doing its role. Now you're the head of the Anti-Monopoly Committee. And again, you can say, okay, laws are bad, other things are bad. But what are you personally going to do? Because you personally, the head of the Anti-Monopoly Committee, to actually demonopolize the economy and make good things. Obviously, we all know we don't live in a perfect world.
I would say it would be highly infantile to believe that there is one person who can demonopolize Ukrainian economy.
No, it cannot. But it can say, for example, okay, you either adopt those laws I don't like, or I quit, or something. Is there anything?
There is an effective utilization of resources. And when talking, for example, about energy, we cannot just come with a gun and say, now it's over. Now that monopolization is over.
But you can see abuse in the monopoly position and apply high fines that they stop doing this.
Yeah, but let me just give some examples. As I said, as we see, and which is proven by the practice of OECD and the United States, European Union, that the catalyst of monopolization and the enemy of competition in most of the cases is the state regulation. We can see it in, for example, in obsolete pricing control. When basically when pricing control, margin control basically moves businesses to collude in order to bypass governmental regulation. And talking, for example, about monopolization. What is the reason why Mao, the famous Mao, is perceived to be a monopolist? It's not because Mao purely.
Because
the state aviation
right?
service, which allowed the distribution of routes to be as it is.
Yeah, but everyone can show, like, blaming others and say, okay, they,
no, I'm not saying we are blaming others. I'm saying we are taking action. Not we are not just fighting the consequences. We are working on the causes. And our work on the causes is that we are doing the job for which we are not that much welcome because it is not as populistic as maybe in other cases. Because it's easy, for example, to impose a penalty on someone, say, okay, it's now 500 million per fine. But a much more difficult job is really to eradicate the
But to me, it sounds like a very effective way to stop it. You say, okay, guys, you're abusing your monopolist position, and that's how it's done in all other countries. And you actually apply 500 million fine to IRSV, to whatever it's called now, Ukrainian International Airlines, but you haven't done this.
But you know, this is what Anti-Monopoly Committee used to be doing 25 years.
No.
No.
It applied very little fines. They had no effect. It never actually did that.
Yeah. Okay. Let me finish. What I mean is that just running after the monopolists and imposing penalties on monopolists is not the right way to change the situation in the market. Because the right way is to influence governmental bodies to discontinue pro-monopolistic practices. And
but how? Can you say how you... Because to me, okay, there are two things. Someone's abusing monopoly position. You either fine them for half a billion dollars and they stop, they really will stop, they will never continue doing this. Or you say, okay, I will go to governmental bodies and I change their approach towards monopolistic practices. It's even hard to understand what that means.
If you look at the practice of European Union...
They fine.
I think the last case for abuse of monopolistic position in the European Union was, I think, in the year 1990.
In 1990? Something abuse like of monopoly position?
When they imposed a penalty. But because the right way to fight abuse of monopolistic position... Check it.
We have an anti-monopoly expert here. Can you tell us? Is it... What kind of amount of fine? A huge fine.
The way for European Commission to fight monopolism is commitments. Okay, but let's stop this technical discussion. What I want to say is that Anti-Monopoly Committee of Ukraine has historic preponderance, so to say, towards prosecution of an abuse of dominant position cases. And,
which you don't think is right, and
this was the wrong approach. Wrong approach in the sense that Anti-Monopoly Committee was actually working as a body which imposed very little penalties to a big number of serial offenders, not correcting their behavior, and basically imposing a penalties of $2,000 on a yearly basis on 1,000 monopolists in Ukraine did not work. It did not serve any purpose.
That's why we're talking about half a billion fine on Ukraine's international airlines for charging $300 to a flight to Ivano-Frankivsk. Because that's an abuse
case,
of an
So basically, abuses which are related to conduct of monopolists, they need to be penalized properly. So therefore, for example, beginning of this year, we had a case when we stopped anymore to allow local territorial branches to impose a penalty of $1,000 on monopolists. We put the case at the level of central office, and we imposed a penalty of 19 million hryvnia, 18 million, sorry, which is, again, which does not maybe completely eliminate the preconditions that such violation can be repeated,
but
at least the ticket is much higher.
Yeah, no,
but
right.
The question is the following. If you look at, for example, the situation in the energy sector in 2015, when DTEC was filing complaints against NERC, NKRI AKP, and NKRI AKP was filing complaints against DTEC. The reason for such just ping pong was that there was no transparent regulation in this market. And if you impose a penalty on the tech can always use as defense that basically any that basically regulation in the sector is so intransparent that you cannot actually trace the conduct. You cannot actually select, single out the conduct of one entity and say that this is only this entity which is guilty of everything. So in order to really address issues of, for example, monopolistic behavior in the sectors like energy, they really need to be corrected from the regulation and from the legislation. And what we did, we did sector inquiry. We issued a set of recommendations to Energy Regulation Commission, to Ministry of Energy, in order really to establish non-discriminatory, transparent regulation in specific areas.
And did it work out? Have they done this?
At least this project received a global award from World Bank last week.
No, but have they adopted this regulation?
They are doing it. You cannot change overnight something which has not been working for 25 years. It is a process, but this process is not populistic. I mean, you cannot say that, guys, here are the scalps, but it is something which really does correction of problems.
So what are your personal plans? So you were appointed for 7 years. You've been there for what, one year?
Almost two years.
Okay, good. So you're gonna. So you think that by the end of your appointment, it's going to be a demonopolized economy, well improved legislation. Do you have any personal goals?
My personal goal is that Anti-Monopoly Committee should be a modern, effective, respected authority. And my job is not just to show the scalps. My job is to really have a transparent system which can work even without my presence. Mm-hmm. And for that, we interact with OECD, for that, we interact with Federal Trade Commission, for that, we do technical projects with European Union, and we want, indeed, a system which is working right, which is not doing the job of regulators or the job of police, issuing, I don't know, penalties for $1,000, but which is a proper European competition.
This is where I disagree. Penalties always work, and this is like everywhere. Like even we've got here anti-corruption experts. You know, American FCPA. Why is everyone complying with that? Because they apply huge fines, even on Ukrainian subsidiaries, and you have to be doing the same.
Yeah, absolutely agree.
And this is clear. This is like, okay, something's bad happening. You apply fines and they stop doing this.
Dmytro, I agree. Penalties should be right. Penalties of $1,000, there are no penalties. They're just tickets which you...
Okay, but why is this happening though? I mean, so you've been around for 2 years. Why is it still penalties for... Because
already,
there are regulations...
There are already significant shifts. Because we can see that last year, for example, if you look at the amount of penalties, again, imposed by Anti-Monopoly Committee, I think that last year was, firstly, there was a penalty on Gazprom, which we should consider separately.
Yeah, but that's a political thing that is never going to be paid, so we don't count that. You can't really say this is, as an example of a large fine applied to a business. Okay, this is the largest fine applied to, like, in the whole Europe, right? Never, ever... It was a fine like this, and it will never get paid, and everyone views this as a political thing, right?
But the amount of penalties applied without Gazprom last year were over 750 million hryvnia. For instance, the amount of penalties applied in 2015 were 300 million. So that means that we are not just going crazy and just imposing penalties on whoever. It means that we are focusing on the right things, because amount of penalty is a reflection of economic damage, which is there in the economy. And to say that Anti-Monopoly Committee should be nice and it is not a punitive body, it is a punitive body for incorrect behavior. It should not be a punitive body for just normal businesses. It should not be a punitive body for those just sending out 1,000 requests for information and then collecting penalties of $1,000 from everybody. Not actually doing the job. So it should be focusing on the right things. For example, if you look at the annual report of Autorité de la Concurrence in France, they have 20 decisions. They have 20 decisions per year.
Yeah.
We have 2,000 decisions per year.
Which is not right.
So
which
indeed,
shows that, you're not focusing on the right things, right?
It should evolve, but it should evolve with a certain logic. Because if we have 5,000 complaints coming to us from businesses and from private individuals, this means that these complaints, these are problems of people which are not resolved elsewhere, in other places. So they need to be channeled to appropriately functioning regulators, appropriately function consumer protection bodies, and Antimonopoly Committee should not simply be the body replacing the dysfunctional agencies which are there on the on our side. So it's a matter of not only our building up of our institutional capacity, but it is also a matter of really developing National Energy Regulation Commission, Consumer Protection Authority. Only then we will be able to really to focus on, for example, 200-300 cases per year and really do the job properly.
Okay, and then last question, but can you answer quickly? So for everyone's knowledge, Yuriy was... Yeah, go ahead. You mean in terms of other people? Yeah, go ahead. Do you have an opinion?
No, actually, they have the opinion.
Yeah? Yaroslav.
Yeah.
But do you have an opinion? Do you have an opinion?
I want to hear all the speakers, their opinion on this stuff.
So you don't? Okay. Yaroslav?
Just a couple of thoughts following what Yuriy said. I know... Yuri will only concur with me to the extent I would like to say that the wonderful world of the competition control and oversight in Ukraine does not belong only to Yuri and IMCU. He represents National Competition Authority. There are also sector of regulators. And Yuri was repeating this theme all over and over again. There is NERC and BU, there are some other guys, and they are not necessarily there to cooperate with MCU to the extent that it is necessary in order to produce the necessary competition effect. So
what's end?
That's
so it's not Yuri's not the only one to blame, or so if there is anything to blame at all, is what you're saying.
In order to have a comprehensive answers to some of your questions, not only Yuri has got to be over there, and
but now we don't have Yuri here, so we don't have anyone. That's why I'm asking Yuri. It's clear, right?
Right. Right, but this is just the kind of food for your thoughts,
okay.
And this is the correct reflection of the realities existing.
Got it.
In terms of, I don't know, maybe Yuri will take it as a sign of criticism or not, but in addition to those fine international financial organizations, there is also, and Yuri is very well aware about that, there is also a systemic report prepared by the Business Ombudsman Council. The principal difference between the emphasis that we are placing in our deliverable is that while we agree with the internationals that you've got to be better financed in order to untap your institutional capacity and stuff like that, we also brought into and put on the table some of the comments that are key for business to feel comfortable that AMCU is there doing the right thing in order to make the competition healthier in this country. Two things I would like you to pay particular attention to, and I very much look forward to continuing cooperating with you guys to make sure that these recommendations are implemented. First is that those investigations into the abuse of a monopolistic position are not subject to any time limitations, as a matter of the fact. You guys have a full discretion. People are saying that you are abusing that. And I know that this is the part of the pedigree that you inherited, but this is something that you can do or facilitate doing when it comes to the changes in the legislation.
But let's not turn it into a technical discussion. This is very technical.
Is it?
Yeah, it is.
But it used to be technical before, no?
No, it wasn't. It was a general question of why things are not done in the pace what some people are expecting. You're talking about some...
So maybe the last point that I would like to raise is that fines can be imposed. In Ukraine, the amount is not challengeable in court. The only thing you can go and challenge is the fact whether you have actually committed breach of the competition rules or not. But you cannot go and say, well, look...
Change the amount of fine. And I think courts should have the discretion to change the amount of fine.
Provided that the methodology will be the same, equally applicable to AMCU and courts, and provided there will be professional judges.
That's a good question. That's a good comment. But not everyone's a lawyer here, that's why. But otherwise, it's good. Question now. The next question I have, unless someone has any comments. Oh, someone has comments. Martin. I can actually, I've got Kirill here, and then Martin, if I can.
My question is, you and other people have been saying the government is doing this. Now, is it institutionalized government that are doing it, or is it vested interests that have infiltrated government that are doing it?
Doing what?
Setting up monopolies, etc., etc. Because it seems to me that there are people who are setting up monopolies who are not actually part of government, but they have infiltrated the government system to such an extent.
Can you give some names? Who are you thinking of?
Kolomoisky is one.
Okay, who else?
In
the energy sector.
Energy sector, airline sector? I mean, interesting that both examples that you've used are the same.
So your question to Yuriy, right?
My question to all of you is, are we actually talking about institutionalized government corruption, or are we talking about individuals who have infiltrated government in order to build their business empires within the governmental system?
Yulia, can you answer? Okay, well, I'll ask Yulia. Yulia, there was part of the government.
I think here we have to clarify. There is no difference between private interests of the people who are in the government and between the distorted institutions, which are not making the decisions. Because, what kind of system do we have today? And what kind of government do we have today? I'm calling that, I don't know how to call it in English, but in Ukrainian we call it okupovani institutsii, occupied institutions.
Can you name those, just so we know what you're talking
any,
about?
Any institution in Ukraine.
That's what I'm thinking, every institution.
Like any governmental institution which is infiltrated with such personalities, they are working not for people's interests, but for this personality's interests. And this is why they are occupied, not by... they are not working for the society. The whole problem is that Ukrainian governmental institutions, they were built as an institution that serves for the interest of these people, not for the broader interest. Like, what we inherited after the collapse of the Soviet Union, we mixed with the criminal mafia interests, and on this basis created, I wouldn't say created, but inherited the institutions. And now our main challenge is to rebuild a completely new governmental institutions, completely new parallel institutions. And like what I've seen from within was not that we can come and fix a little bit something and these institutions will work for the people. No, these institutions, like the law was written to create the monopolies, not to avoid them, unfortunately. Like the, we have to rewrite most of the legislation and we have to rebuild most of the institutions. And corruption and personalities and oligarchic interests, they all are mixed and working together right now.
Unfortunately, can you hear me now? No. Does the thing work? No? Does it work now?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. Okay, good. I think that's a good answer.
That's just generalizing, but yeah. We still have a lot of hope.
But then the next question, okay, it's all sort of bad in Ukraine, all these institutions with all corrupt, but okay, you were part of Odesa Customs. What have you personally achieved much in actually trying to fight this system? Some specific examples, because you know what people say, when people like public activists get appointed, they say, okay, people like young, inexperienced, know nothing about customs, it's not really serious, you're just getting appointed there to make public perception, okay, something's been done, well, you've really had no chance to change anything. Do you think you achieved any significant results?
I think we should ask business that worked with Odesa.
No, but what do you think? I think there are obviously different views, but what do you think? And in terms of fighting this system, because there's also obviously lots of these people who were there at Odesa Customs. It's one of the most corrupt things in Ukraine, like billions of dollars going through there. And then there's Yulia appears there, and is it even possible? Was it even possible to change anything?
The thing is that when I was appointed, we had a clear plan what to do and
that's good.
A clear understanding, like step by step where we're going and what results should be achieved. And,
but wasn't the first step is to remove all of those people who you knew were corrupt? Have you done this?
Let's come back to the beginning. I was appointed and announced by the president to do the pilot customs terminal in Odessa, to pilot the reform which would be nationalized after the success. That was the main idea of this walk. In 4 months, we understood that the president wasn't really interested to support the reform of the customs.
Not interested.
Unfortunately.
Why do you think it's the case? Because he's the president.
I understand that's not a presidential vertical, he signed growth.
So it's not because it's not because of some.
That's more like a political thing. But nevertheless, we tried to implement the main principles of civilized customs in Odessa. And I hope those who worked with us actually find out that we cleaned not the, that wasn't the question to get rid of people. Like, for example, I had 1,400 people working in 35 checkpoints and 5 seaports. And we had 750 customs officers who were working with the declarations on the checkpoints. How could you control them and get rid of everyone?
You should have, because otherwise, if these people were taking bribes for their whole life, they're not going
to
change.
The idea and the actions was to get rid of the chance
to get a bribe by a customs officer.
A customs officer. Okay. That was the approach. Because how do you get in the bribe when you work on customs, and why do you get in this bribe? Because you can, if I am a customs officer and you're a business and you want to, and I want you to bribe me, I need a reason. And main reasons were first that the customs value, and you know about that. You're coming with your goods, and I can make a decision if your shoes that you're bringing cost.
Or they can just delay things forever, right?
That was the subjective decisions that were made by customs officers forever.
And you took
customs.
It away from the discretion.
And our business ombudsman could say that that's... deputy. But
yes.
That's the main bribery area at the customs. What did we do? We made rules where the customs officers had no right to make these decisions. How did it work? For example, you brought your shoes from Italy, and we... trust your documents. Our rule is that if your goods are coming from this range of countries, if you're a company with facilities in Ukraine, if you're a trusted taxpayers, if you're a company with a good reputation, then our customs officers, these 700 officers, had to trust your documents.
But Italy is one of the most corrupt countries in the European Union, so why would you choose Italy? I mean, why don't you say from the UK or something?
UK also. We had
Italy was...
I'm just giving you the idea how it works in civilized countries. We used a model of Singapore,
just apply,
US, the idea is that...
Remove discretion from these people.
You're taking away this right to make a decision. We achieved the result in it, because during the year when I worked in Odessa, 600 new companies that were never cleared in Odessa came and started work there. Among them,
and I think the other way around, right? Lots of companies that use corrupt schemes, they realize, and I think this is an example, this is a reflection of your work, that lots of corrupt schemes moved, that's what people say, to Kyiv and other, but they stopped working through Odessa.
Yeah, that was like the shadow.
Yeah.
This
is a good thing.
That was a clear decision. If you cannot, if we cannot walk, completely honestly with the company, we're not going to work with them.
Yeah, excellent.
And that was the problem.
Okay, so then why did you quit? In a few sentences.
The thing was that I was appointed to start the customs reform.
And after
we spent a year there. We hired 124 new customs officers. We trained them with the U.S. customs officers. We did legislation, so on. But nothing was approved by the government.
So you didn't have the cooperation from the government, and you stopped.
Yes, half a year, it was a complete fight with Nasirov, Grossman, presidential team, and so on. And unfortunately. It was a great pleasure and a great experience to work with the business, because I know what I learned from that experience was that the only interested part in a society, in the reforms, is the business. Not the oligarchs who would preserve these corrupt institutions forever because they benefit them. Not, unfortunately, the poor people who are surviving, but the business is the main interested part of a society to work with.
But only proper business, that is not business, like business that uses its monopoly position to make super profits, right? I mean, talking about other businesses.
Yeah. Like not those who benefit destroyed institutions.
Exactly, okay. Yeah. Oh, that's a very good answer, thank you. Then the next one is, my question is to Mikhail Merkulov from Arricano, if I can. So, Mikhail, you had one of the most discussed corporate disputes, your company had this one of the most discussed corporate disputes, where a foreign investor, Estonian foreign investor, built a business, found local partners, and then the local partners took away business from the Estonian investor, then somehow Estonian investor took his business back. But we're not going to talk about specifics of this corporate dispute. But just can you tell us, what do you think, what are the lessons learned by you, by the Estonian investors? What have you done wrong? What has the investor done wrong? And what should other sort of investors do to avoid similar problems? Or is it possible to avoid similar problems in Ukraine?
Thank you for the question. First of all, I would say this is the unique experience that one might get, you know, having such a story. The story lasts for 5 years already, and the uniqueness of it is that the international investor, actually this is not one personality, this is a group of investors. One of them is the British fund Dragon Ukrainian Properties and Development. The group of investors have invested in the property in Ukraine, and the property was raided, not without the state registrars. Yeah, these are sad stories that we have heard in the past. And during the 5 years, we have won everything that we could in other jurisdictions, and we have won nothing in Ukraine. Yeah, these are sad realities which we have here. And having won last year the LCA court in London, now we face the situation that we have to receive the asset back, and the opponents are absolutely ignoring the decision. So we are now evaluating what would be our next steps. But the thing is that the legal issues are legal issues. Yeah, they are on some landscape, and we have some pressure that international investor is facing, because our topic today is the pressure on business. So I will tell you a little bit about pressure. So when I was joining Arricano, nobody told me that I will have to go to the prosecutor's office and be questioned. And after the first questioning, which lasted for 4.5 hours, I thought, well, this is the memory that I wouldn't like to keep. And as the CEO of the company, I can tell you that it's really difficult to manage people, especially top managers, who are to be prepared to go to be questioned by prosecutor's office, police, national security of Ukraine. They go there, they are questioned. Afterwards, you have a session with them, yeah, to psychologically recover them. And of course, you are not exempt of delivering business results. So this makes working in Ukraine really unique thing. It brings a lot of drive. You should be really well prepared for that. You should have a lot of energy.
Unless they lock you in the prison, right? Then drive is not going to help you. But
yeah, you know, we're quite careful, you know, not telling a lot of names.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you know, a couple of managers from our company are still under suspicion. Yeah, they are suspects in fake criminal cases.
But what kind of, you can't say this, is it fake criminal, like business-wise, or did they come up with something completely irrelevant to the business?
I'll give you the example. So the criminal case against one of our lawyers is based on the fact that somebody in the corridor of some court heard that somebody passing said that Arricano's lawyer wanted to give a bribe to a judge. Okay, so there are 5 volumes in that case. There is no questioning of any witness. So five volumes, no questioning of the key thing.
Yeah. So this is all made up, obviously.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. It's clear to everyone. But have you used the help of Yaroslav, business ombudsman in this case? Because he's there to help.
Yeah,
you.
They are helping us a lot.
Are they helping
actually,
you?
Actually, yeah, we are in close cooperation with everybody who can give us a hand there. We are working closely with ACC, with EBA, with the business ombudsman. And actually, they have helped us not only in bringing this case up, but also in other cases. Famous examples are VAT receivables, you know, this electronic administration stuff. Last year, all of a sudden, 12 million of VAT disappeared from our account in the electronic system. Yeah, with the help of guys from Business Ombudsman Office, we received that back. So it 12 million miraculously disappeared and miraculously appeared back. You know, so our government is doing miracles.
That's actually a good story because, you know, VAT, it's historically been one of the most corrupt VAT refund things, and businesses have been given huge kickbacks. And even FCPA, there was an FCPA case when an American company was given kickbacks to Ukrainian tax authorities to give this VAT refund, and you're saying that it's actually possible to just go to Yaroslav and he will just help you, so you don't have to give 30% back kickbacks. That's a very successful. That's a very good success story.
I will tell you even more. You don't have to go to Yaroslav.
Yeah, Yaroslav will go to you, right?
Yeah, no. This is even more civilized.
Okay.
You know, we were among the first who made a claim to Business Ombudsman Office. And first we were taken back by the fact that we seemed to fill out everything on their webpage. And we were refused. So it turned out that we didn't fill it in the right way. So we said, okay, what did we do wrong? We corrected ourselves. We resubmitted the form. Then we received the confirmation immediately. Then in 10 days, we received feedback. So it worked so smoothly that I thought, okay, we are probably not in Ukraine anymore.
Okay, so everyone who has issues with VAT refund, they should stop paying bribes, they should stop paying kickbacks, 30% huge amounts. They should just think this is a very effective tool based on your experience. Business. It's an advice to other businesses.
Well, I wouldn't say that.
They should stop paying.
You know, if you have a right business model and you are aware of the tax regime in Ukraine and you are ready to pay all the taxes, you should not have tax issues in Ukraine. Yeah. So we don't have. Yeah. We are the public company listed on AIM in London. We're paying all the taxes, so we don't have issues.
What about customs? Yeah, you have an issues with customs?
We don't.
You don't have any issues with customs?
We don't work with customs because we're not importing or exporting. We're just building shopping centers.
Can I add here, for business, when we cooperated and always had a meetings with business discussing what should be changed for the better and so on, you know, main advice was not to pay bribes, but to pay your lawyers. Like, this system is very weak.
I agree with that.
This system is completely
and everyone
weak.
Should understand it. No, definitely.
And it's easier to fight with it than to trying to be a part of it.
Exactly. I think that's a good advice. Okay, thanks, Mikhail, for sharing that. Next question to Sergey. So, Sergey, I think your story is very good story on your website. So, the story of the company, not your personal story. Company, as I understand, was focusing on the Russian market before, until 2014, then Russian market obviously closed, and then after that, you've restructured your business model very successfully, so that you're now exporting to 30 European jurisdictions. You're no longer dependent on the Russian market. But can you tell us, in terms of difficulties, is the company still facing difficulties in Ukraine? And maybe the difficulties are so bad that even considering all of the attractions of Ukraine, like cheap working force, maybe some people say qualified employees, hopefully. Are you considering not only selling to other countries, but also moving production facilities? Or hopefully not. Hopefully Ukraine is a good place to do business. Can you tell us?
Thank you. Good question. Of course, we were offered from Russia, from Baltic countries, from Poland.
Even from Russia?
Even from Russia to buy plants in that countries. But that's
a bad advice, because look at Poroshenko, he bought a plant and now...
No. Thanks God, we refused that offer, and it is our choice to conduct business in Ukraine. We have a lot of plans here. We have some experience not in only in productive business. Before we were the bankers, you know, we were the owner of Bank Aval. And of course, it is difficult even just now with new authorities to conduct business. And we have met a lot of times with, at first, tax authorities, local tax authorities, and then as far as it our business is concerned, ecological authorities, because we have a lot of plans with some difficult processes. Even in new condition, food safety authority. We have bad examples.
What is a bad example? Bad example is like Jonathan recently had a bad example. He had a dawn raid. You know, when he came to his office, there were people in the masks.
No.
You're talking about some different bad
example. They have another approach.
And actually, Yuriy had a similar bad example as Jonathan. So they've got a lot of similarities.
It is easy.
So what kind of bad example? Yeah. So
they make it easier and
for you. So how come it's so easy for you? Or do you think Ukraine is such a good place to do business in?
For us, it is.
Do you have any politicians? It is
good
as part of your shareholders. So what's the magic? Oh, you do. I haven't checked.
What do you mean? What
as part of what is the magic? Why is it so easy for you to do business in Ukraine? It just is.
At first, we don't have experience to conduct business in abroad. So we try to fight with difficulties. And of course, all our time we apply to court, Ukrainian court. And thanks God, we were as a winner a lot of times. Because we refuse to pay bribes.
It's obviously a very good choice, but why? Because some businesses would tell you, okay, it's impossible to do business in Ukraine without paying bribes. And I can say it is possible to do, but why? How did you come to that conclusion?
Yes. At first, you are right. Sometimes it is easier to pay,
yeah.
And more quickly, to pay bribe and go ahead. But we know, today bribe, tomorrow bribe, after tomorrow bribe, and what in future? So we decide to fight with bribers.
So it's not.
You know, it is difficult. A lot of time, a lot of nervous, a lot of meeting with different people, different guys. But what to do?
So you listen to Yulia's advice, it's better to pay lawyers,
yes,
than pay bribe.
Yes, last decision of court, appeal court in Odessa, we won a deal for more than 100 million hryvnias. More than 100 million hryvnias. It was difficult, it's more than 6 months fighting, but we showed that we will do such a way in future.
Oh, it's very reassuring.
With any authorities. We are sure that it is good.
Was it customs or was it tax? Tax.
Tax.
In Odessa.
Tax,
okay.
Authority. Yeah. Not it was not Yulia.
It was not
Yulia's
Yulia.
Department.
Okay,
no.
Okay.
Thanks God. But
very good.
In another region, we have example and from customs authority.
Well, thank you, Sergey. That's very reassuring. Kirill had some question. Kirill is a very well known economist and partly politician and businessman.
Yeah. So we have a connection. Right. Thanks. So. Like a pre-word, I want to say that Aval Business Group is one of the business groups which you want to look at, to learn from, because as I know that
this group made most like the business was always open. And when I saw when there was a dispute regarding the sale of Boris Loshkin Media Holding, and then there was a question from Oleg Leshko to Fyodor Shpik, you're one of the senior partners, that I know that you didn't pay taxes for sale. And when Fyodor published the invoice or for the payment check for personal income tax, which he paid for the sales, I was so shocked because I couldn't even count the zeros for the check, you know, where it was a huge amount. So I think it's just an old school, you know, it's just an old school type how you make the business. Regarding the, I was as a youngsters who want to change the countries from my side, I'm always thinking on the antitrust, anti-monopoly, because what we have here now, the economy is shifting, as Mr. Yuriy confirmed, that the economy is shifting from spendings on the small business, on middle business, to large corporate business, which are gathered at the, like on the, which we call monopoly. So the economy is totally shifting on the monopoly side. So the all the spendings, like we have the poor people. We the average income is so low that the minimum wage is like minimum, like we have in some countries.
Can I proceed to the question then?
Yeah, I mean, it's not about the question. It's about the difference.
Oh, you have to ask questions.
I will make the difference and then I will ask some question. Like from one side, we have Yulia Marushevska who tried to change something. She resigned. She tried to do something step by step. And from the other side, we have Yuriy, which complains about the regulations, which complains about the NERC, which complains about all the, you know, the third parties which are doing something, and he couldn't achieve, he couldn't make some changes.
Actually, he made lots of changes. No, I'm not, I'll tell you. We practice in this industry, and improvements are huge.
Yeah, right. But from the perspective of the consumer, I don't understand.
Because you don't necessarily feel it immediately. But I'll tell you that in terms of anti-monopoly regulations, in terms of the progress which has been made, it's the most progress which was made during the 25 years. So I wouldn't say Yuriy hasn't done it. He actually done definitely more than others. But would you say, okay, can you even do more than that?
Yeah, right. So my question is there are a lot of youngsters which have to go further, which have to go to the cabinets, which have to be passed
question.
The power, right?
Question.
So the question is, how do you proceed? You fight to the end, or you simply...
Will you quit?
Yeah, will you quit?
Okay, that was the whole... Because I think, I'll add to this too. Okay, the good example about Yuriy, lots of people from business come to government. I know many examples like this. Business is different from government, you can say lots of things, but at least you have motivated people, maybe better educated sometimes people, more, and you get to a totally different environment. And lots of people, they just scream, everyone's an idiot here, I'm not going to do it, it's impossible. But some people actually, they withstand this and go through all of this, and this deserves lots of respect. And I think part of the question was, how do you find it? And I this is a compliment to you from Kirill, I think.
Yeah, sure,
it is. So
for me, actually, I'm in a privileged position because after 10 years in Metro, which is a German transparent retailer, I had 3 years in ArcelorMittal, which is a former Kryvyi Rih Stal.
Okay, so you were prepared already.
To a big extent, there are still some rudiments of Soviet processes there, and indeed there is this huge transformation still ongoing after 10 years after privatization, with a huge fight against thefts, against internal corruption.
Fight against what?
Internal thefts. because the plant used to be, there were a lot of leeches around, just sucking everything they could out of this enterprise. So for me, this transfer was a bit smoothened, I mean, from multinational business to governmental institution with really a huge metallurgical business in between. I would say that the biggest challenge which I have, which I see, is not just just catching low-hanging populistic fruits, saying, okay, let's impose a penalty of 1 billion here, let's impose a penalty of 1 billion there, but really to do substantive change in the system. And substantive change in the system inside the authority, which has never been result-oriented, which has never had really a sound basically priorities and KPIs in place really to estimate and evaluate the efficiency of the body. And secondly, also to do an external change, because we are not the only entity just promoting competition. We are protecting competition. We are enforcing competition law in order to stop abuses, but which is our primary function. But to develop competition, it is a common job. It is a job of Ministry of Economy. It is a job of regulators.
Okay, no, it's clear.
And the most complicated part of my job is really to push also others in a synchronized way forward.
Yeah, but how do you do that? Okay, there's lots of people there who receive very low salaries, maybe disinterested in what they're doing. So how do you motivate them?
It's a traditional Slavic approach, inviting foreigners, which is 2,000 years old.
Hold on, but you okay. So
it's firstly, for example, to really have a transparent roadmap for reforms in the authority. We work with OECD, Organization for Economic Development and Cooperation. We have really developed over the last 6 months a plan of recommendations to be implemented, really to change the authority.
No, but secondly, how do you motivate regular workers, regular employees, like deputy head of some department? Why, okay, he receives very low salary.
And second, what we are now working with World Bank is National Competition Development Program, which should be it should be at least an institutionalized process for not only Anti-Monopoly Committee, but for all governmental institutions to work in single direction with a set of principles to promote competition, with a proper diagnostics about current problems as a starting base, for example, so that we could assess our efficiency and effectiveness of our activities. Regarding motivation, indeed, motivation in the public sector is the most critical problem, because I see that, and it is actually, it's a landmine, it's the biggest threat. Because you can easily attract people who are now enthusiasts. But enthusiasm is a very potent fuel, but very, very short-lasting. Because enthusiasm, if it is not fed with reality, it turns in frustration.
So what do you do?
At least what I can do, we have selected in our authority key individuals, 10, 15 people. It is possible, for example, really to, even in the public sector, to pay decent salaries. Not several thousand dollars, but really to pay decent salaries.
To 10, 15 people, you said?
Hmm?
But what about others? Okay, it's easy to implement. Okay, but because I'm sure it's not just monetary motivation, but what do you actually do to motivate them? Do you tell them, okay, now it's your lifetime opportunity?
No, long term, it needs to be resolved. It needs to be resolved systematically. So, firstly, headcount, number of staff should be reduced from 750 to maybe 500 or less. And secondly, really salaries need to be not just increased by 10%, but they need to be, for example, they need to be planned properly. Like, for example, National Anti-Corruption Bureau or others, they have salary system starting from 20,000 hryvnia. So in competition authority, it is 5,000-6,000 with just a regular small, just an ordinary employee. So directors of departments, they have higher salaries. But from my perspective, indeed, professionalization of public service is the key remedy to success.
And I think everyone would agree.
Public service needs to become professional. It needs to become. It needs to be stopped just to be the just swamp for people who cannot find a job in the private sector. But I see it's the biggest challenge. And this is basically number one recommendation in OECD peer review, that financing of anti-monopoly committee, I'm not saying only anti-monopoly committee, it's relevant for every public authority, that basically financing needs to be made appropriate. Because how can you call it, how can you be even talking about an independent authority with a salary of, I don't know, $200?
I think that's right. I think you're right. Yeah. Jonathan, you have some experience at Ukrnafta. How do you motivate people there?
I think what I've learned in the year and a half I've been there is most people, you're not going to be able to motivate, actually. You have to be very ruthless.
You have to fire
and you
people.
Have to get rid of people.
Yeah.
It becomes pretty clear pretty quickly who's blocking. There'll be...
Have you done
lots
this,
of reasons,
Jonathan,
yeah. So now,
how many people have you fired?
Okay, so in our head office, we've taken out 20%. But the key, the key is that we've taken out the leadership that was there before. So everywhere we have new department heads. Some of them are very young people who are inexperienced. But it's better to have these inexperienced people who've got the energy and drive than to keep the old people there who will block you and resist you and destroy everything you want to do. So actually... You can't motivate most of the people. You have to be utterly ruthless. That was perhaps a mistake we made, thinking we could motivate people in the early days. We learned we can't. So, you know, the old guard have gone. We have only two of the leadership from the Kolomoisky era in the year and a half we've been there. An example, we had a structural unit we wanted to reform. They wouldn't reform. What did we do? We found a young lady from IT who was just energetic, and we made her the director of this department.
But did she have enough knowledge? And you know,
it sounds like
a good story.
She knew what needed to be done, and within a week, all the senior people resigned. So that was pretty good. We cleared them out just like that, and our supervisory board has now agreed to get rid of this structural unit. So you know, there are lots of ways you can do this, but I think my message is don't think in an old state organization which hasn't been reformed for 30 years, 40 years even, that it's going to be easy. It's very tough. You have to push very hard, and you have to be quite ruthless.
That's good advice. Anyone has any questions in the audience? We've got one, two. Someone has a microphone. Is someone helping us? Okay, I can do that.
Question to Yuriy, very practical question. Some time ago, we have all heard the announcement of the Minister of Infrastructure, Vladimir Amelian, that Ryanair is coming to Ukrainian market. Today, we all read in the newspapers that the director of the Borispol airport is not really welcoming the Ryanair in Borispol airport, referring to some order of the actually Minister of Infrastructure in terms of the fixed tariffs at this airport. At the same time, we all understand and know that the base operator is MAU, which effectively receives or received in the past the discounts at this airport. Not just the discounts, but only the discount in the form of huge payable to the Borispol airport, which they have already announced many times they have no will to pay. So I'm not a lawyer. My question to you, as a citizen of Ukraine, do you see any role of the State Anti-Monopoly Committee in helping Ukrainians reach the offer which Ryanair has already announced to them?
Yes. The question is, I think currently we have a case in our pipeline where Borispol gave to one air company a discount of 80% on tariffs. The issue is that it's now and again. Yeah, we are coming to the same topic. We cannot be subjectively good or bad. We should be transparent and non-discriminatory. And issues like, for example, Borispol Airport. We cannot just say that let's give to Ryanair or to any other air company which is doing just one flight to Borispol a discount of 90% because Ryanair is good, because then other air companies are also good. Borispol should just have objective, transparent, non-discriminatory tariffs which are applicable to all equally. And they should not favor one company, which is Ukrainian, or, for example, another company, which is, we believe, is a strategic partner. And we are looking at this issue, and we are working with Borispol airport tariffs. As I said, we have a case in our pipeline, but it is not only about air companies. We are also working about access for handlers, about access of service companies. And this is indeed a topic on which we work since summer 2015. All elements which end up in the cost of airline ticket, talking about underdeveloped Ukraine aviation industry in Ukraine, we should not only be talking about air company, we should be talking about the whole chain, starting from airports, tickets, fuel access. Every element of this chain has its bottlenecks. Because, for example, in some airports, we had cases that only one company could operate as a fuel for fueling of aircraft, and tariff was two times higher than in the airport where several companies, for example, could compete. So we are indeed working.
Sorry, we're talking about the same owners, yes? Mm-hmm. In some airports, the same owners as MAU, they only had access to fuel companies, but, you know, it's related parties also.
Borispol is it's a state airport, and we are talking about Dnipropetrovsk. In Dnipropetrovsk there are problems, we are working on them. But as I said, and there was a question before, that most of monopolistic, we hardly have a competitive market in Ukraine which is monopolized. Normally all our oligarchs, they are working either in the areas of public natural monopolies or in the areas where governmental regulation helps them to keep monopolistic position. So this is also a good example of that.
Okay, yeah. I think it's okay. So I was told that we only have 10, 15 minutes. So can we then? Okay, there's a question. I think what I'm going to propose, if we can, shall we ask one last question each of the. Each of our panelists. So Yaroslav really wants to talk. If someone has a question to Yaroslav, please, someone needs to have a question to Yaroslav. He's a deputy business ombudsman.
Yeah,
please.
Hi, I have a question.
To Yaroslav.
Everyone, Yaroslav may answer if he wants.
Yeah.
I'm Olena Tregup, I work for the Ministry of Economy, and I'm one of those enthusiastic outsiders who joined the government after the revolution. And it's really interesting that today you were talking about pressure on business, but half of you ended up talking about public administration, because those are the people who create regulations which then pressure business. And my question to you, what is, in your opinion, we are right now, we have entered the third year after Maidan, but the public administration reform did not really happen. And when you were talking about OECD recommendation to increase the salaries, this is so basic that I was even, laughing, because I'm dealing with the same issue, of course, at my position.
So why were you laughing? You agree with that or you don't?
I agree with that.
Of course.
My question is, why it wasn't done in 3 years?
Because the country, there's a poor country, doesn't have enough money.
Okay,
right?
this is your answer.
I don't know enough. I'm from private sector.
I want to
Have lots of money in Ukraine? Where are they? Oligarchs?
I want to hear their opinion. Why this reform has been so much delayed?
Yaroslav? I see straight hard talk.
Right. Well, I can only answer that have this reform been properly implemented and systemically implemented, it would have alleviated some pain, that's for sure. I would say that from the typology of the abuses that we see across the whole board of state authorities that we are dealing with, the ramification of the lack of this reform is that the existence of these discretionary authorities that is so descriptive of any state official to hell is actually being used in this country as a precondition to actually, exercise some illicit creativity to induce people pay you bribe or you know otherwise abuse your authority. Of course, in the normal circumstances, if you are even in normal jurisdiction, of course you need to have a discretion because the scenarios that you got to deal with when you are kind of supposed to serve the business
but it's not easy to understand, though. Because how can you remove any discussion? What are they going to do? This is what they're there for.
No. I mean, this is exactly what I'm saying. Right. Is that you can, and that's kind of a bottleneck of a situation. Is that you can reform the legislation as much as you want, but the existence of the discretionary authority is inherent to any. You know, state official or institution when it comes to the need to have this flexibility that enables you to adjust yourself to the various, scenarios that are not necessarily repeating itself. That's where the negative implications are, and that's... Indeed, something that manifests itself from the local self-government, and in an ironic sense, due to decentralization, what we're seeing is the increasing trend of these SNGs being probably the most difficult folks for us to deal with, because... they are so independent, many of them are actually elected officials, that we end up being less efficient with them in comparison vis-a-vis, let's say, imaginary ministry or a law enforcement body that has this vertical from bottom to up. And if you are having a guy who is running the agency on top and is having a political will or is willing to sort of exercise us as the platform to prove that they are genuine in their attempts to at least tackle some individual cases that we are bringing to them, or maybe even show some commitment to do some systemic changes, well, then we are having the tangible results that are characterizing us as actually being quite efficient, even though we don't have any binding authority. Yeah,
so. All right, thank you very much. And then can we just continue with asking questions? A question to Yulia Marushevska. Very good.
Yulia, I'd like to ask you about your decision.
Do you need a microphone, though?
I'd like to ask you, Yulia, about your decision to resign. I understand that it was what I would call a principled resignation, which means, in my definition, a resignation based on a dispute with your superiors. And by resigning, you hope to improve the situation, shed light on a problem. And using that definition, do you feel you've accomplished what you intended by your decision to resign?
Thank you for the question. You know, when I was appointed, I wasn't really happy to be a chief of customs. That wasn't a position of my dreams, and that wasn't a job of my dream. And for me personally, it was a position of being a reformer. And that's the thing that motivated me, and that's the thing that I wanted to do, to change the institution and to show the result, that the most corrupt institution could be changed and can be modern. In my case, in a year, I ended up as a chief of customs. Not as a reformer, unfortunately. We did the best we could in the current circumstances, but me and my team had no possibilities to do a real reform. And I had a lot of people under my responsibility. I promised a good salaries. Like, I'd like to come back to the question that Olena Trigub asked. Like, I deeply appreciate her work in the government. She left Washington and spent almost 2 years in Ukrainian Ministry of Economy. And the question about the reform of the public service, about the normal salaries for the actual managers of our country, is so crucial here. And in my case, it was also very important because I hired these new customs officers. I promised them a normal salaries. For 6 months, we were paying them like this 300-400 hryvnias, which is impossible to live on. And they were, you know, this...
So you're seriously like, talking about 300 hryvnias?
Yeah,
3,000
hryvnias? Yeah, 3,000 hryvnias.
3,000.
Okay. Yeah, but that's, you know, that's Odessa. Even Terentyev flight will cost you more. And that's the... you know, that's the world you are facing. No will to reform on one side and, like, real people that you're responsible of on the other side. And I'm not. I couldn't have. I couldn't say I'm satisfied with the result of the experiment in Odessa for myself. But I'm satisfied with the result we showed for the business, because we showed that even this corrupt institution, being known, you know, in the region as the deep hole of corruption, could work properly. And it doesn't take you years. It doesn't take you, you know. I love this statement being done by consultants who consult us for like decades, that you cannot make reform fast. It will take you like 20, 30 years. You know, countries were built for hundreds of years. I'm not sharing this point of view.
Who says this? Are you talking about American advisors or talking about locals?
You know, a lot of different interested groups are saying that because it's really beneficial.
But you don't think it's the case, right?
The salary of an advisor is about like the lowest range is $2,000-$3,000. The salary of the customs officer is 3,000 hryvnias.
So they're on a different, live in different worlds.
Of course, right? Those guys, they can advise forever. And yeah. I need these people to work right now, honestly, and to conduct the results and not taking bribes. You know?
And the interesting view is that you said that you think that the government has money to raise salaries for government officials to market levels.
Yeah, I want to stop on this point to clarify it. How crucial and important the reform of the public service is, and how important is Olena's question about 3 years of not doing it. Because not paying the salaries for our managers is creating this vicious circle of corruption.
No, I think this is clear. The unclear thing is that where is the government going to take money?
And it's been done for purpose, because we do have this money.
Where?
Olena will tell you that a year and a half ago, we had a huge possibility to take this money from European Union, who were ready to finance the
Okay, so
of the
some external sponsors would be paying for Ukrainian government.
They were ready to do that for a short time. And we do have this money inside our budgets. I know how that we spent billions on not having normal managers. We are losing losses in on corruption in Ukrainian customs is billions of hryvnias per month. Like that's all these operators and so on.
So you mean if to make all things work properly,
paying normal salaries, you know, it's not something to discuss that we don't have this money. We do have this money to pay normal salaries.
I think the other way. We would have this money if we were to reform the country, is what you're saying?
No.
We have it now.
We have it now. We should take them. I love to. I think Max Nefodov was making a good point that the price of it was 3 months of paying good normal salaries for Ukrainian officials was the same that Ukraine spent on Bank Mikhailovsky. You know this story was giving the money back. Like that was the price of Ukrainian normal of a normal management of Ukrainian government of Ukrainian state. Mm-hmm. You know, that's not because we don't have this money. That's because we don't want to have an independent state officials. That's because our government is benefiting from this vicious corruption circle. I'm sorry.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm sorry. Good answer.
I'd say maybe there is also one aspect to that. Even within the current budgets. It is possible, for example, by optimization of staff to increase salaries to people. If you say, for example, there are 1,000 employees in a public organization, you reduce it to 500, and then you keep the same personal expenses, and you raise twice salaries. But regretfully, the more you decrease the staff, the only the basics, they continue to perform. Because there is still a huge useless turnover of bureaucratic documents. For example, in 2015, we issued as Antimonopoly Committee opinions on 1,400 acts of legislation. It is impossible.
Impossible, yeah.
It is simply impossible. So this document flow
five a day,
basically keeps you busy. It's you're running in circles. It is meant. On the other side. It's just one observation. Second observation, normally people in public positions, they don't last too long, unfortunately. And if you just get into this water, you first just start to swim, and then you start focusing about internal organizational improvement. And I would say that people who are there in the position for 1 year or 1.5 years, they're simply not even getting to the level of
understanding
of internal processes. Because I remember that I was appointed in May, and I missed completely the first budget process. Because just by stepping into the position, I know that already my people, they prepared a budget proposal for the next year's budget, and they simply had to accept it. Next year, I already started to manage it. But you manage it. I mean, you manage expenses part, you manage, you understand some projects. And only this year, I already have really budget management. So I can come with a proposal, for example, to the government, really about some proper organization of processes, mm-hmm. about maybe IT improvement. So and
I think that's understood what you're trying to say. Yeah. Okay. No, very good. Anyone has a question to Jonathan?
As I've got the microphone, thank you. A lot of what we're hearing about is complaints about salaries, etc. But the underlying cause surely is the black economy. Yeah, and the amount of business that's happening outside of the eyes of the tax authorities, etc. Yeah, and it's a question to the whole board here, I guess, which is to say, well, we haven't seen much reform that's even tried to tackle moving black into grey into white. And what are you?
No, we've seen Prozora and other things. So there have been reforms. So what is the question?
Has that really made a big
impact? Yes, of course. Okay. Yes, definitely.
I still see a huge amount of black business running around.
Yes.
And my question is what do you see for business as well as from a government perspective? Where are the wins that we're going to get to start to really move the black economy into the white, which will start to solve a lot of the questions that you're trying and wrangling with at the moment?
So who do you think is Jonathan?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I call it value leakage. So, you know, as you think about where is the money disappearing to? Where is it going out to? And a key area for us in Ukrnafta has been procurement. So we focus straight away on changing our procurement process, taking people out, bringing consultants in to reform it, taking a large number of people involved in it. There were a typical item procurement required 70 signatures to work its way through the system. So everybody having an opportunity to take a cut. And then, of course, we discovered that the vast majority of requests to procure never worked in the end because they went to the wrong person, you see. So you know, that is a big source of value leakage. Now we are, another one is that we produce hydrocarbon, oil and gas. That doesn't all get to the market. There's all sorts of ways of taking it out of the system, theft, what they call technical losses, not recording the production from a well properly, transport. We have a huge transport fleet. There's a manipulation there. We're actually going to put GPS is on every vehicle. So the way to do it is think about where is the money disappearing from your system.
So can I say three main things? First is procurement. Second is theft.
Procurement. Then dealing with your production processes. What is disappearing in it? Why are you not getting the full value? Modeling, sophisticated models of what's okay. happening in your manufacturing. And then you can begin to do it. And, of course, changing the people and motivating the people. One big example for us is we're now gradually moving into a KPI system, and people are going to get very large bonuses, you know, 50% of salary for achieving the right things.
That's very good. Okay. Then next question to Mikhail. Excellent.
Hi, Mikhail. I have a question, actually. I think out of the whole panel, you're the one who experienced the pressure probably the most. And my business is actually going through the same thing.
There are lots of people disagreeing with this, sure.
Yeah, well, my business has been raided 6 months ago. Our property has been re-registered. We're in courts at the moment. We are facing the fact of the administrative pressure in court, so we know already we're going to lose, like you said. So my question to you is, you started fighting 5 years ago, and you're fighting against, let's say, the government, because the people who are pressuring you, they're pretty much in power now. We are fighting the same people. The question is, when you started, NABU didn't exist. Did the National Anti-Corruption Agency actually help you? And the second question, what is the hope and what's next?
Yeah, that's a really good question. First of all, our story is outside of the scope of NABU. There are different stories with the same people which NABU is working on. They have asked us to provide documentation on our case, which is connected with those officials you're talking about. We have provided everything we have regarding our case. It's a good thing to know that they are working on that. We know that after first unsuccessful attempts, they are learning. Yeah, they started to be more prepared for some actions, and we saw recent actions. Yeah, with the head of tax administration. Yeah, they are learning. They are improving. So once they are ready with that case, I think they will fire. So NABU will not be much help if this is the business dispute. What would be of much help? It's if you have an investment outside of Ukraine, then some investment dispute, disputes against the state may be the option that you may look at. Of course, you need good lawyers. You know, we have the number of lawyers in our organization exceeds 10% of organization. This is nonsense.
Yeah. Talking about private companies.
For private companies, this is nonsense. Yeah, we have number of lawyers as for small legal company. Yeah, but this pays off because you constantly are defeating the company from the state in different spheres. For example, every year we have a new criminal case is in one of our locations. That we didn't pay this payevoya, you know what this is the
participation fee.
A version of a communal fee, mm-hmm. but this is a completely corrupt fee. So every year we fight against it because we show the payments, we show the documents, we show the bank transfers. Yeah, but this is a lot of administration, this is a lot of protection. So I encourage you to fight. I encourage you to make this public, to involve everybody that you can. We're working with all the organizations. So good luck to you. If you want to some ideas to help, we are always ready to share.
But Mike, just to add, you said you won everywhere except Ukrainian courts, right? Which
That's
means
correct.
That now you have a decision, let's say from London Economic Court or from somewhere that says that the property is legally yours. But I'm assuming that Ministry of Justice is refusing to take it into the execution.
It's not about the Ministry of Justice. We actually are supported by the Ministry. They have acknowledged that they have done, their workers have done mistakes, illegal mistakes, and this should be followed by a criminal responsibility. Yeah, but the procedure is that they transfer this documentation to the prosecutor's office. And this is now the prosecutor's office job to start the criminal case.
The one who's questioning you for 4 hours, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, same authority. So instead of doing their job, they are pressuring the business.
All right.
Yeah, so if anybody has an idea how to reform that authority without just swiping
the NABU prosecution office.
Prosecutor's office. Other than without swiping them out, and bring completely new people.
But I think that was exactly what Jonathan said. It needs to be done.
That may work.
Right? So I mean, not with the prosecution office.
So the hope is only that we have the new government, new politicians. That's our only hope to actually restore our property. That's exactly what you're saying.
Eventually, we will have that. And I may be a little bit cynical here, but this is again coming to the question of low salaries of state workers. Look, why we have such slow change of everything that we have? Actually, there are two motivating factors, pain or pleasure. Yeah. Who has the motivation to change? A small portion of people in this nation, and the biggest part of this nation is still mentally there in the epoch where there was a good Tsar who was controlling everything. Yeah. And the problem is that they don't think. And one of the biggest problems of Ukraine is populism and the populists. So once somebody says, okay, let's increase the salary of the judges to 300,000 hryvnias. Immediately populists, and you know well who they are, immediately they are on TV saying that it should not be the case, they should get 3,000 hryvnias, and 80% of the population agrees. So until they agree,
That's sad. That means we need to change population, and there's no way to do it, you know? So that's a bad conclusion.
No, I didn't say that.
No, but it sounds like...
I said that we should stimulate them to think.
Stimulate population to think.
And
even more difficult.
Population will stimulate politics to change. No, and this is our job. Yeah, we should do this education. Yeah, otherwise, you know... There should be more than 10% of the population to stimulate that. Let's work on that.
Okay.
Thank you.
And thanks for this wishful thinking. Anyone has question to the representative of the milk company, Milk Alliance? Oh, very good.
Alexey Sashenko, Red Cliff Partners. I'm actually colleague of Dmytro. And as a lawyer, I can say that, I can feel that pressure on business still continues. But looking at what has been happening in the country and with the pace of reforms, I mean, I can confess that there are lots of changes and lots of positive changes. We obviously would want to have some changes, quicker and in a more efficient way. But looking at Yuriy, looking at Yulia, comparing them and a number of other governmental officials, comparing them with the previous officials, I mean, this is a night and day difference. So they are educated, they are professionals, they speak English, etc., etc. So, but my question is more to business people here. Despite all these reforms, which I feel that they are going, but in your sense, in your feelings, do you think there is some kind of progress? Is it getting better compared with what it used to be 3 years ago, 4 years ago, 5 years ago? And also, perhaps Yaroslav can shed some life, some light in terms of the changes, because you've been seeing and witnessing lots of complaints against the officials.
Okay. Let's start with Sergey, maybe as a representative of the business.
As far as I'm concerned, I feel positive changing in authorities, in government, but on the other hand, a lot of old approaches we feel almost every day in our business, especially on the regional level, because young leaders in the government, it is good, but on the local level, they have huge deficit of young, educated, and professional guys or ladies, and they have old generation, and they don't want to change something. It is comfortable for them to stay in the past. And a lot of example I could show you from locals that they are they stopped our progress.
Absolutely.
But one good point. Just now, since society, since even Facebook, we have opportunity to press on authorities and show society that they are doing not right. And sometimes they afraid and step back.
Sometimes they're not, but we know what happens if they completely ignore it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, okay, let's do this one last comment. So Yaroslav is going to answer the same sort of question, if there is progress or there is no progress.
Right. We're certainly happy that this experiment to set up an authority that does don't have any binding power is actually effective, because our reputational leverage is structured in the right way in terms of who set us up and how professional, I guess, are the people working there. And you know, the percentage of the individual recommendations that we are issuing exceeds 80%. So we are quite happy about that aspect. But look, there are certain areas where we would like to see further improvement. Where it's virtually absent is the systemic changes in the legislation, which would root out the grounds for these abuses to even exist at all. You know, we are hopeful that tax administration reform that kind of took place and entered into force at the beginning of the year will be the move in the right direction. There is one area that I am responsible for, which is getting hooked up to electricity. This is kind of an ironic thing. When we started to take care of that area, we were 186 in the world by doing business ranking. Right now, please congratulate me and everyone. We're 137.
Very good.
Improvement, very good, but not good enough, I guess. So, and some of the you know, arrangements that we are making our efforts tangible are dependent not upon, again, some systemic sort of a structural fortified in the legislation or in practice things, but upon the existence of just the political will or the part of the leadership of the particular agency and stuff. And that, of course, makes what we do somewhat vulnerable. Yeah, to changes. So we would like to, you know, see the situation moving towards the direction where there will be more systemic changes, both institutional and the procedural.
Excellent. I think that's an excellent concluding remark. And I think we're going to stop unless someone can't hold itself from asking one last question. Okay, excellent. We're going to stop. And... go ahead, you.
Good. That's why I couldn't hear you. It wasn't turned on.
Now we can hear you. I was going to say you need to speak up a little bit. Everybody, I know that this has been, this is a pilot episode, is what I call, of something new, but I see that there's a lot of interest because we went way over time, basically, on this. But I feel that there's a lot of questions, and I have a feeling that it could continue even longer. So these sessions are going to continue getting better and better and better. But it's because of you that we started all of this. And so thank you for coming. And thanks to our moderator, to our sponsors, to, of course, all the speakers. I know a few of you have been doing the rounds at different events today, so you're like rock stars as far as I'm concerned. And I'd like to give over the microphone to Adisa, who was organizing, who was in charge of putting this together. So anyways, from Kyiv Post and for everybody in the team, thank you very much for coming. And I look forward to the next one and to some champagne.